Achette Audio presents When Silence Kills, written by Mark Griffin and read by Tamsin Kennard. Chapter 1. At 39 years old, V still believed in fairy tales. She still believed that a person must be loved before they are lovable, that the goodness of the soul will always triumph over evil, and that the princess is as likely to be the hero of the story as the prince. But most importantly, the fairy tales helped her escape and imagine a world outside her own. Her lycra skirt had rolled up to her hips with her last John, and she pushed it down to her knees when they had finished. She watched him pull his trousers up and buckle his belt, then scurry away until he disappeared into the car park. "Good night, Prince Charming," she whispered. V had been a sex worker for over 25 years and had kissed a million frogs. The coastal town of Brighton in the south of England had a small red light district. A few other girls were smoking and chatting, arms linked, extra protection in the early hours. At her lamppost, V brushed her teeth and lit up a cigarette. She was watching a car that had been circling all night, a dark-coloured Volvo that would pace and slow, and then lower a window and move off. "All right, V?" V turned. She hadn't heard the girl come up behind her. Thin legs and thin arms, a platinum wig and a smear of red lipstick. "Got any smokes?" the girl said. "Two, and they're mine for the walk home." "You're fucking useless, aren't you?" V stared at the girl. That's all she was, a girl. 14, maybe 15. She wanted to give her a stick of gum, but instead she gave her a pack of condoms and baby wipes. "Don't say I never give you anything," V said. Ulyana was Ukrainian, with a shoulder-length blonde wig that she changed every other day. Her accent was thick in places, soft in others, the Cyrillic R religiously rolled. "He's back again," V said.
"The Volvo?"
V nodded and said, "What protection do you have?" Ulyana pulled a small switchblade from her handbag.
"It won't kill him, but it will make him stop and sink twice."
The Volvo slowed to a halt by the curb. One of the girls leaned through the window, a few seconds of conversation. Then she ducked back and walked away, gave the driver a finger and told him to fuck off.
"Who was it, Ali?"
V shouted across the street. The other girl shrugged, went back to her friend and pulled another smoke.
"I'm gonna go home," V said. "Stay, keep me company. Can't be asked. You want to do something tomorrow?"
"Sure.
How about I cook for you? Sunday roast."
"It's Friday."
"Don't care," V said. "I bought a chicken yesterday from Aldi. Fat little bugger he is. I'll get him out of the freezer tonight and put him in the oven. What time do you want to come over?"
"Late afternoon. Then we can walk here together for the night shift."
"Perfect."
The girl smiled at her. V tried to smile back, but her jaw hurt.
"If you look good, you feel good, right?" V said.
The girl nodded and gave V a hug before she turned and walked away. It had been a hot day, but the nights by the sea were always chill, and as V walked along Marine Parade, she listened to the waves breaking on the beach. The first cigarette took her to Rottingdean, and by Telscombe Cliffs, she had finished the second. She lived in a one-bedroom bungalow on Wellington Road. It was white-painted with an entrance porch and a large square window to the right. The curtains had been pulled shut, but sagged apart in the middle. The front gate creaked as she pushed it, but everyone else in the street was asleep. She put the keys in her front door and opened it and switched on the hall light. Her sobriety diary was on the hall stand, and she wrote day 278 and put an X by it and said, "All it takes is faith and trust in myself." In the bedroom, she unstrapped her heels, pulled off her top, and kicked her skirt onto the bed. She showered, and when she got out, the bathroom mirror was misty. She wiped it down and gave her reflection a cursory glance, played with her dishevelled red hair,
then brushed her teeth. She took the chicken out of the freezer and checked the vegetable cupboard. Carrots, parsnips, potatoes, and she could go out and get some frozen peas tomorrow morning. She made a cup of coffee, didn't mind the chipped mug, and leaned back on the charity shop sofa in her pink-walled living room. She used to get lonely when she came home. She used to think she needed someone to survive, a partner. But that was because she always thought she was never enough by herself. Now she knew she was enough. She had changed. She was getting her life together, and this time she was getting out of this business for good. She stared at the TV with one elbow on the arm of the sofa, a cigarette scissored in her fingers. After an hour, she realised she was falling asleep. She should go to bed. Her hands were starting to get cold. In the hall, she heard a knock at the front door. It was 3:30 in the morning, and she hesitated before she whispered, "It's late. Who is it?" A voice, unfamiliar. "Who?" The same voice, but muffled, so she opened the door. V pulled a smile from somewhere and said, "Do I know you?" And suddenly there was a memory. A memory of a burning princess dress. And V's smile vanished, and she couldn't breathe, and felt herself falling towards the floor. Chapter 2. Holly Wakefield stared at the small bungalow with its bright yellow police tape. It was at the end of a cul-de-sac on a slightly upward-sloping road. Either side were more bungalows, and beyond, a housing estate with an acre or so of grasslands. Her phone rang. It was D.I. Bishop, and he was running late.
"I had to get something from the police archives," he said. "Traffic is bad. I'll be there in 20 minutes. Go in. Don't wait for me."
A pause.
"Get a feel for it by yourself."
The phone went dead. Holly didn't carry a handbag. Everything she needed was in her pockets, including a pair of forensic latex gloves, which she snapped on without breaking stride. She lifted the police tape around the front gate and showed her ID to the officer stationed at the door. "Holly Wakefield," she said.
"Right. D.I. Bishop said you would be coming. Do you need anything?"
"Just privacy, thank you." He nodded as if he had been expecting as much, opened the door and moved out of the way as she stepped inside. Holly heard the door click shut behind her. She had no idea what to expect in the house. Bishop had been cagey about giving her more information, which was strange. She stayed very still and took a deep breath. The coppery smell of blood mixed with stale perfume. There was a diary on the hall stand. She opened it up, a sobriety book for Alcoholics and Narcotics Anonymous, and the last entry had been Thursday, with a 278 and an X next to it. There were telephone numbers and people's initials scattered throughout, with appointment dates and meetings with sponsors. The small bathroom on the left was neat and painted blue. The living room and kitchen on the right were painted pink. There was a retro radio on the mantelpiece that was pink like the walls, and there were beach shells, an empty vase, and books on shelves. Lark Rise to Candleford, Shakespeare, and a book about ballet by Darcy Bustle. There were no photos anywhere, not a single one. Laundry was scattered across the radiator, and in the kitchen, plates and cutlery had been left in the sink. A few flies buzzed, and it was beginning to smell.
"Get a feel for it," Bishop had said.
The victim's name had been V, and profiling the victim was just as important as profiling a killer, sometimes more so. If you wanted to get to know your victim, you had to tread in their shoes. V had been a sex worker in Brighton for the past 11 years, and was known to the police. Holly turned the radio on to the last station that was listened to. It was Heart FM. Talking Heads and then Johnny Cash started singing Hurt. She sat on the side of the sofa that was worn and sagged and stared around the room. This was what V would come home to. cheap prints on the walls, a few shells from the beach, and lipstick-kissed cigarettes in ash mugs on the coffee table. How did you end up here, V? Holly had been brought up in the foster system after her parents had been murdered, and knew how easy it was for girls to get sucked into prostitution, having seen it firsthand, and knew the torture of wanting intimacy and closeness, but never knowing where to find it. She had heard many versions of the story over the years, and it made her sad. A mix of poverty and desperation, abuse and no one to talk to. Maybe V had dreamed of becoming a ballerina when she was a child. Classes after school, auditions and rehearsals, but then somehow ended up mixing with the wrong crowd. Hash had turned to coke, coke to heroin, and by then all morals and principles had left the room. Holly wondered how often V sat on this sofa and thought about everything that had happened in her life. She got up and made her way along the hall. There had been no signs of a struggle, so it appeared the killer had been invited inside. A regular client, perhaps? Or at least someone V recognised or knew at a distance. There was no blood anywhere in the house, apart from the bedroom, so that was where she had to go. She pushed open the door. The curtains were drawn, so it was dark, and she flipped on the light. Dozens of bright yellow evidence tags littered the room. The bed had been stripped by the Socco team. There was a blood-stained mattress and an empty brass frame entwined by fairy lights and fluffy animals, multicoloured bears, dolphins and a unicorn. Not the bed of a jaded sex worker, but the bed of a woman who liked to pretend she was still 13 years old and living at home. Different men, different sheets, and Holly wondered how often V slept alone, crossing off the days in her diary and drying her eyes. Blood spatter on the walls, the carpet and the ceiling above the bed that had gone brown. There was a partial red handprint on the wall behind the bed. V had been alive when the stabbing had started. Holly took a moment, then climbed onto the middle of the bed and stared down at where V's head would have been. This is how the killer would have done it. And from her position, Holly could be right there with the murderer, witnessing events. She had a sudden sense of him and what had happened in that room. She could hear the music from the radio, and she could feel the anger, the fear and the smell of the blood. The fluffy animals watched her with their plastic eyes, and she eased herself off the bed and took the rest of the room in. No photos, but things that sparkled, clothes with sequins that would reflect the glow of the streetlights. The chest of drawers was full of skirts, bras, underwear, and denim. She sat in the wooden chair at V's dressing table. In one of the drawers were sex toys, handcuffs, condoms, and Tic Tacs. The lipstick and eye makeup were metallics, sparkles, and glue sticks. In the other drawer was the first photo Holly found, and it had been tagged by forensics. It showed a teenage V with copper-coloured hair and her arms around a boy of about the same age. They were both smiling at the camera and wearing costumes from a drama of some kind or fancy dress party. There was nothing written on the back. She became quiet and still as she tried to piece together what she was seeing and how it made her feel. Lonely. Sad. The thought made her look up in the dressing table mirror and glance at the reflection of the bed. Her imagination gave her a glimpse of a heavily built man leaning over V, hand repeatedly dropping and raising the knife, deep, throaty breaths with every strike and the creak of the mattress as he killed her. She blinked away the vision and stood up. After the kill, he would have wanted to see what he had done, breathe in that feeling of power, until it slipped away like a shadow. He hadn't rushed. He had been calm and very much in control. And then he had placed his calling card beneath some stockings on top of the chest of drawers. The police had left it for her. A single piece of A4 paper with a drawing of two childlike stick figures in frenzied streaks of coloured crayon. She picked it up. The figure on the left had a grinning balloon head, and held a knife in one hand. The figure on the right was the victim, and she had been drawn with long red hair and eyelashes, and was wearing a green dress made up of three straight lines that formed a triangle. Spread-eagled on the bed, her face was a mess of reds, and where her eyes should have been were scratched black holes. Holly ran her fingers over the waxy surface. She had never seen anything like it before. There was a realness about the figures which was disturbing on so many levels. Childlike, infantile. But the violence. She frowned, and her eyes were drawn away as she heard a noise that startled her. She hadn't heard the front door open, and now footsteps scuffed on the carpet. A hulking shadow appeared in the doorway.
Holly?
It was Bishop. 6'2", ex-military, and she could smell the polish on his shoes. Hello, Bishop, she said. He met her at the dressing table and removed two plastic evidence sleeves from his jacket. In each one was a childlike crayon drawing of two stick figures, the grinning killer on the left, the bloody body on the right. Holly stared at them for some time, trying to elicit an answer. Where did you get these? She said. Bishop? Bishop was very still. It was as if he had shut down.
He's back, he said.
Who's back, Bishop? Who? But he couldn't answer. He was just staring at the drawings, as if he were somehow lost in time. Chapter 3. Who is he? Holly said. Holly and Bishop had ordered a fry-up brunch at Fat Jack's Burger Bar on the promenade. Sitting at the window, they both had a view of the beach and the pier. Families braved the pebbles, carrying hampers and deck chairs, and the sea was a briny green.
We never even got close, Bishop said. I was still a sergeant, only 4 years in with the Met when the first body turned up, in May 2013. The victim's name was Stephen Freer. He was a 65-year-old retired GP who left behind a wife and two children. His body was found in the bedroom of his house in Croydon. He'd been drugged with chloroform and GHB and stabbed 10 times in the face, mainly in the eyes. He had also been castrated, and the missing body part was never recovered.
Jesus.
No CCTV, no DNA or forensic evidence, and the killer left a stick man drawing. This was body number one, and the task force conjured up all sorts of ideas as to who could have done it. But as we checked into his past and patient files, we found nothing. He was well-liked by work colleagues, friends and family members alike, who were all questioned and eliminated. We brought in every ex-con or recent release we could find, and then after 4 weeks, the press and television lost interest, and we had no new clues or suspects, so the investigation ground to a halt. After 8 months, the task force was reduced to a skeleton crew, and I was one of them. I'd never felt so helpless. I'd go into work, thinking today's the day we get our break, but it never was. It was as if we were waiting for him to kill again, to see if he'd tripped up next time. 2 years went by with no new leads, and the murder was classified as a cold case. I got assigned to a gangland killing, but I never forgot about it. I don't think anybody did. We all accepted it was probably a one-off, so everybody moved on. Until the summer of 2016, when the second body turned up.
Same MO? He nodded.
The victim's name was Mike Thomas, and he ran an art gallery in Sunbury. He was killed in his bedroom, a 30-minute walk from the gallery, drugged with GHB and chloroform. 35 years old. Stabbed 20 times in each eye and castrated, and the killer left a second stick man drawing. Again, there were no witnesses, no forensics, and no CCTV. The task force was re-established, the cold case reopened, and we tried to find a link between the two victims. But everything was a dead end.
There was nothing.
We had 50 officers working on it, organising major press coverage, and we brought in analysts, psychologists, even school teachers to talk to us about children's drawings. We had one shrink tell us the castration had all the hallmarks of a sexual sadist.
It does. The men were degraded and humiliated after death, she said. The killer wanted to punish them beyond killing them.
Yes, but it was the desecration of the eyes that stumped everyone, he said. See no evil. That was what the press ran with.
Holly was remembering some of the details of the cases now. She knew she probably had copies of the original newspaper articles back home in one of her files. She had an extensive homemade library on serial killers throughout history.
We had anybody who ever displayed a warped phobia about eyes brought in, Bishop said. People do that, you know. Makeup and stuff to give them teddy bear eyes, doll's eyes, cartoon eyes, clown's eyes. There's a scary interview if I ever did one. Never realised there were so many people who still dressed up as clowns for kids' parties. We even had an optometrist come in and talk to us about emetophobia. You know what that is?
Fear of the eyes.
Not just fear of the eyes, but the fear of eye contact. Social situations when you have to look at someone. Touching your eyes or getting something in your eye makes people feel queasy. And we wondered if that could be something to do with it. Windows to the soul and all that crap. The need to destroy that fear.
Did you ever have any suspects? Holly said.
A guy called Ralph Macquarie was a person of interest for a while. He was a homosexual rapist who had been in Broadmoor for 7 years on attempted murder charges.
Were either of the victims gay?
No. We had circumstantial evidence against Macquarie. He was seen on CCTV near Sunbury train station an hour before the murder, and then again walking around Hampton Court an hour after, with no account of where he went. CPS said it wasn't enough. It probably wasn't, but it was the fact he was a handyman that made us look twice.
Why?
The power tools at his home. The pathologist concluded the castration had been done with an electric saw. Everything in his workshop was tested, but he kept his tools religiously clean, and we only found one trace of blood on a sander, and that turned out to be his.
Where is he now?
In Felton Prison. He got arrested for rape 3 years ago. He gets out in 6 months.
Holly hadn't touched her food, nor had Bishop.
You're not hungry,
he said. No. He scrunched up his napkin.
Come on. I can't remember the last time I walked along a beach.
They mixed with the crowd heading to the sea.
What were your first impressions of the murder scene?
Bishop said. Holly took a second, reliving those feelings. He's not afraid of making a mess, which suggests the killer is highly organised and will carry his full murder kit with him, including latex gloves, possible socko suit or equivalent, and a full change of clothes. It looks as though he took her into the bedroom quickly.
To have sex?
To kill her straight away. I don't think this is someone who wastes time with small talk.
He could have killed her anywhere in the house. Why the bedroom?
The same as the previous two victims. It's a smaller space, more contained, and therefore easier to control the victim. But I think he chooses the bedroom because it's more personal as well. It's the one place where we're supposed to feel safe in our homes. They were quiet for a while, still walking.
What about the victim?
Bishop said. Do we have a real name for her yet?
Just V.
I think she was a woman who'd spent most of her life fighting demons, trying to make the best of a bad situation. She was strong, independent, and according to her diary, was a regular at AA and NA. She seemed to be turning her life around. 278 days sober. There was nothing particularly personal in the diary or her house, as if she didn't really belong there, apart from the one photo of her with the young man found in the dressing table.
Lover or brother?
Either or. What are the other working girls saying?
They're a tight bunch, with the customary horror stories. They've all been helpful, but they're frightened they could be next. The local police have already brought in the usual suspects, but so far, every one of them has an alibi. There was a Volvo spotted in the area the morning V was killed that hasn't been traced. Apparently it kept circling, then driving off.
Had any of the girls seen the car before?
No, but it was pretty conspicuous that evening. And if we can get a plate number, we'll put it into ANPR. One of the girls saw the driver, but just described him as dark-haired and wearing a hoodie. She thinks there was another man in the back seat.
This was well planned, and the location was pre-selected, Holly said. The killer would have followed her home from where she worked, not just once, but many times. He had to know for certain her daily and nightly routine, where she ate and where she bought her groceries, if she lived with someone or had a pet she had to come back to and feed.
He studied her.
With precision.
You think the killer knew her?
Yes, she said. I do. Chapter 4. Holly and Bishop stood on Morley Street. Two local plainclothes detectives were talking to a group of the working girls. Some smoked, and those that didn't had their hands stuffed inside jacket pockets against the chill air. One of them looked over and made eye contact with Holly, then looked away. They're skittish, Holly said.
They think we're from immigration.
A commotion among the girls. Choice language, pantomime gestures, and then one of them came over. It was Ulyana. Today she wore a black wig, but she'd still gone with the red lipstick. She told them she had been in Brighton for 3 years after leaving Portsmouth, trying to work on her own without a pimp.
I've been stabbed 3 times, and I have no idea why these men attack me. Nika, one of the girls over there,
she pointed past her shoulder with a cigarette,
was shot at last Christmas. Fucking Coy Holover.
Coy Holover?
Bishop said.
Dickhead.
She wrapped her arms around her body as she spoke, shrugged, but it turned into a shiver.
We are all scared, you know.
I understand that, said Bishop.
How well did you know V?
She was like a mama bear to me. She used to take care of me. She gave me condoms and told me how much to charge and what not to do. I don't have a bad word against her.
Did you know her real name?
V? That was it? What's your real name? Holly asked.
Ulyana shrugged.
This Volvo that you saw, Bishop said. Can you tell us any more about it?
V said she had seen it coming and going all night, but it wasn't one of our regulars.
Did V have regulars?
Some.
She shifted in her high heels.
Do you know who they were?
No, we don't watch each other. We get our johns and then we go somewhere quiet.
Where?
Ulyana pointed.
Around the corner, over there behind the bank. We go where there's no lights. That's what the men want. They don't want to be seen.
Did V ever mention anything about her past, where she was from? Holly said.
She never talked about the past. But she was clever.
Clever?
She could have got a job somewhere, you know, a proper job. She knew things that I would never know.
Like what? Holly said.
Like poetry and stuff. She would say things that were beautiful. She talked about love, Romeo and Juliet.
She was romantic. She used to give me candles to burn at home. Do you know if she was seeing someone?
Like a boyfriend? No, she'd been single for years. It's hard to find someone that isn't a dick, you know. She used to go out with a drug dealer, but I think he's dead now.
Do you know his name?
Bishop said.
It was before I came here. Can I go now?
The girl sniffed and looked at Bishop.
I want my knife back, she said. They took it from me when they told me to speak to you.
Bishop waved the two plainclothes detectives over and took the knife off them. He opened it, folded it up, and placed it in Ulyana's tiny hand.
Don't kill anyone,
he said.
Chapter 5. Holly and Bishop agreed to meet V's sponsor at his home. Robbie Sweep lived in a one-bedroom flat on Manchester Street, a 3-minute walk from the beach. He was tall, over 6 feet, and in his 50s, sandy-haired and large, wearing jeans and a vintage Clash t-shirt. He smiled awkwardly as he took them into the living room, where tea and coffee was already waiting.
This is horribly sad,
he said as they sat down.
I've known V for 3.5 years now, and counted her as a friend. V was AA and NA, that's alcohol and narcotics. And yes, I was her sponsor for both. I was smoking crack at 12 and drinking a bottle of Jack every day for nearly 15 years,
But then I got clean, and I'm one of the lucky ones.
And you knew what she did for a living?
I have no judgments. She was a good person. When V first came to the rooms, she did what most people do. She poked her head in, had a coffee and a biscuit, then disappeared for a week, sometimes a month. It's a cycle that a lot of people have to go through before they come back.
Holly was content to let Bishop lead the questions, and she watched Robbie throughout. He sat open-legged, arms across his lap. He seemed very relaxed.
So, as her sponsor, what did your relationship entail? We spoke 3 or 4 times a week, sometimes for 5 minutes, sometimes for 20. She would tell me how she felt and what she was doing. And how was she feeling? Had you noticed a change in V in the past few months? A change? Did she seem more nervous or apprehensive? No. It looked as if she was really getting it together. She was over 9 months clean, which was huge for her, so we all thought this was the one. What about a partner? Bishop said. Do you know if she had anyone in her life? I don't, sorry. And when was the last time you saw her? That would have been on Wednesday morning. There's an 11 o'clock meeting at St. Peter's Church, just down the road. Was the meeting busy? About 15-20 people. It's always like that. It's pretty regular. Was there anybody new there, or someone you saw recently, perhaps talking to her, that you hadn't seen before? No, not that I remember. I mean, the thing is, people come and go all the time, so some people don't like who chairs the meetings. Some people will feel uncomfortable with other people in the room if they recognise them from another anonymous group. So it's a constant shift, to be honest. But she was comfortable with you and the group. She was, and we were comfortable with her.
Bishop took a second, and then...
I know you pride yourselves on your anonymity, and this may seem a little inappropriate, he said. But were there any men who knew what she did for a living and made advances to her within the groups?
It was the first time Holly had seen emotion on Robbie's face. A flicker, but it was there.
I think she would have said something, Robbie said. A lot of people in these rooms come from abusive homes or relationships, and they're not used to standing up to people. But V had found that strength. So, no, I never noticed anything like that, and if she had been approached inappropriately, I think she would have dealt with it. Thank you, Robbie, Bishop said, and stood up.
All three shook hands, and the big man walked them to the door.
I don't know how long you are staying in town, he said, but we're holding a vigil for her tomorrow night. It's open to everyone. We're going to light some candles and say some prayers.
Outside, Holly and Bishop walked to the beach. There were no clouds, and the sun was hot.
You want an ice cream? Bishop said.
They both got Mr. Whippy vanilla ice creams with a 99 chocolate flake, then left the pebbles and found a path that led towards the pier.
Brighton and Hove police already ran Robbie Sweep through the system and he's clean. But I'll ask them to get a few plainclothes officers to go to the vigil and see if the killer turns up, Bishop said. You never know. We might get lucky.
It was his standard phrase, but Holly said, He's not coming back here, Bishop. He's done what he needed to do. Her eyes drifted down to the beach where there was a sudden breeze and she could smell the sea. The last time she had been here was with her parents, 7 months before they had been murdered when she was 9 years old. They had all gone down to the palace pier and she had been dressed like a princess, walking in tiny flip-flops and getting dizzy on candy floss. When's the autopsy? Holly said.
9 o'clock tomorrow morning.
Chapter 6. Holly was glad to be home. She lived on the 5th floor of a block of Georgian flats in Balham, southeast London. 2 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, and an open-plan kitchen and dining room. It was an area she had grown to love, with a literary festival, a comedy festival, and the Bedford Pub, which was a local institution. Once home to the likes of Eddie Izzard and The Clash, it stocked IPA and served a cracking Sunday roast. This was the 3rd case the Met Police had asked Holly to assist on. Normally, She lectured on forensic psychology and criminology at King's College in London on Mondays, and the rest of the week was spent at Wetherington Psychiatric Hospital, where she tried to get inside the minds of men and women who were lost to the normal world. There was no pill to cure the lust for cold-blooded murder, no antidote to help them tell right from wrong. But Holly had made it her mission in life to find the hidden truth behind the shuttered eyes of psychopaths. On the last case, which had seen her save a young boy's life, she had been called the psychopath whisperer by the press, an epithet she neither cultivated nor cared for. Going back to Brighton had affected her emotions more than she thought it would, and after showering, she found herself looking through a family photo album. Photos of her parents on Brighton Pier and on the beach, smiling to camera. Her mother was wearing the silver and enamel butterfly necklace that her father had bought for her on their first anniversary. It had been her mother's favourite piece of jewellery and had been stolen on the day she was killed. Holly reached up to her neck, her fingers tracing the collarbone as if the jewellery was somehow there. She put the photo down and moved across to three large shelves in the living room, all crammed with books on forensic science, criminology and psychology. There were homemade files as well, which she had created with newspaper cuttings and essays about serial killers that had caught her attention over the years. Dr. Crippen, Hugo Schenck, Marianne Cotton, Jack the Ripper. Their dark dreams and the motivation to kill of those people who walked without conscience. Her fingers gently traced the spines of some of the folders, and she hesitated at one labelled The Animal, then carried on until she found British Unidentified Serial Killers. She pulled the large scrapbook down and sat at the dining table. The pages were glued with dozens of grainy newspaper photos of different crime scenes, page after page of press speculation and images of shadowy figures. She stopped when she came to an article dated 23rd of May, 2013. See no evil. Met police launch probe after 65-year-old man found dead at his home. Police have launched a murder investigation after the body of a man, who has not yet been publicly identified, was found by officers called to a family residence in South London. Police gave no details of any of the injuries, but stated it was a particularly violent crime and said a post-mortem examination is underway. According to Detective Chief Inspector Eddie Walker of Scotland Yard's Homicide and Major Crime Command, specialist officers are supporting the man's next of kin. Officers have been deployed to search the nearby area and are conducting house-to-house inquiries while closing off the street until further notice. No arrests have been made. The next article was dated 1 week later. The body of the 65-year-old man who was killed at his home has now been officially identified as Stephen Freer, a doctor from Croydon. He was stabbed repeatedly in the face and the eyes and horribly castrated. Detective Chief Inspector Eddie Walker says it is the most disturbing crime scene he has seen during his 15 years as a Met officer and has vowed to do whatever he can to bring this madman to justice. One man, who cannot be named for legal reasons, is helping the police with their inquiries. The deceased leaves a wife, Anne, and two children. Various insights and articles followed for the next 3 months, and as she turned over a page, it was suddenly 3 years later when the next body was discovered. 12th of June, 2016. A murder investigation has been launched after a man was found dead in his bedroom in Sunbury-on-Thames last Sunday morning. Mike Thomas was a 35-year-old art dealer who owned and operated a gallery in Sunbury. Officers from the Met Serious Crime Squad attended at around 11 a.m. after receiving a call from his wife after she returned from visiting her parents in Cheshire. Neighbours were warned they could expect to see a heightened police presence in the area. Early reports say the crime scene has eerie similarities to the unsolved murder of Stephen Freer, a doctor from Croydon who was found dead in his bedroom in 2013. Both men had been stabbed multiple times and were castrated. a childlike drawing that was apparently left at the crime scene and has since been inspected by forensic scientists, is now believed to have been left by the killer. Anyone with any information is asked to contact the Met Police on 101 and please quote Operation Devon. 2 weeks later, a police spokesman has announced the Met believes the murders of Stephen Freer in 2013 and Mike Thomas in 2016 were carried out by the same killer. No connection has been found between the two victims, however, and the killings appear to be random crimes of opportunity. Detective Chief Inspector Eddie Walker, who headed the first murder inquiry 3 years ago, was due to retire this year, but is staying on at the helm of the investigation until the case is closed. Holly made coffee and found cooked chicken in the fridge. She mixed it with salad in a bowl and started to eat. Above the fireplace in the living room hung an original oil painting by Harland Miller. Death, what's in it for me? She removed it from the wall and leant it against the back of the sofa. In its place, she taped up the newspaper articles and the crime scene photos in order of their timeline. Stephen first, then Mike, and now V. On the wall above them, she wrote the timelines of the murders on the wall in a thick black felt pen, and then printed off a map of Brighton and one of London, and stuck them underneath. Above each victim, she put the copy of their stickman drawings and compared them with their family photos. It suddenly dawned on her. The stickman of Stephen Freer was bald, like he was in real life. Mike Thomas had a goatee, and so did his stick figure. V had scribbled red hair and the green triangle dress. He's drawing them, she realised, which begged the question, did he also draw himself? The stick figure of the killer was always on the left and had a big head with big teeth, long arms, and the knife was in his right hand. She wondered if the coroner had been able to deduce from the wounds whether the killer was in fact right or left-handed. She wrote on the wall, right-handed? Mobile. Does he drive? Volvo? Man in photo with V. Who is he? AA and NA. Candlelit vigil in Brighton tomorrow night. Time between kills. Strange. 3 years. Killer in prison? Then she drew an A4-sized square on the wall and put a question mark in the middle. Wrote the word killer above it. Stared at it for a few seconds, then wrote underneath, deep-seated hatred of men and now women. The change of gender in target is unusual. Male victims' castration equals emasculation, and he takes their body parts as a trophy, his power over them. What did he take from V? Was she sexually assaulted? Humiliation. Suffering. She stopped and pulled away. Somehow she still had the smell of the blood in her nose. Sexual gratification. Yes. And she raised her pen and went back to the wall. Masturbation? Possibly, but would have worn gloves and condom. You know your victim's movements and where they live, and once inside their house, you attack fast. Organised, she wrote, and double underlined it. All the victims attacked and killed face up, not face down. So you could watch them as you killed them, or because you wanted them to be able to see you. Why take that chance and risk being seen or recognised? Because it's important to you. She stared at the homemade incident board, an artist studying her first attempts at a sketch. You want to be seen, Holly said quietly. So show yourself. Chapter 7. The morgue was kept at a constant 2 degrees, and Holly hoped she would never get used to the smell. There were 3 steel tables, but only one was covered in a white sheet. The walls were tiled, as was the floor, with a steel gutter that sloped gently to the centre of the room. Angela Swan entered through swing doors, gloved hands held high. Morning, Bishop. Morning, Holly. I made the preliminary examination last night, but there are a few things you should be made aware of. Angela was the chief pathologist for West London and had helped on both previous cases Holly had worked on. She was in her 50s, with a sculptured face, and her hair was brown, streaked with grey. She turned her overhead mic on. It is Sunday, the 5th of May, 2019, 9:05 a.m. This is Angela Swan, D.O., and in attendance is D.I. Bishop of the London Serious Crime Squad and Holly Wakefield, forensic psychologist. She pulled the white sheet away and revealed the body underneath. V lay like a Carrara marble statue, white-skinned and glistening from head to toe after being cleaned. Neat stitches in her chest down to her waist from the Y incision. A white towel had been draped across her face.
Do we have a positive ID yet?
No,
Bishop said. The victim is to be identified for the record as V. That is V-E-E, no last name. The clothes and jewellery she was wearing have all been bagged and tagged. Exhibits 53 to 59. You will find detailed descriptions in my notes. Stomach contents showed she hadn't eaten anything after about 8 in the evening, although she'd had a coffee at some point later on. Her blood alcohol level was zero. Urine samples revealed she had no STDs. Toxicology report says yes to chloroform and GHB.
We believe the killer used the drugs to subdue her, Bishop said.
GHB is usually swallowed in pill or liquid form, but sometimes it's injected. I found old track marks on the insides of her elbows and between her toes, but nothing recent. Chloroform, on the other hand, smells. It's sweet and pungent, and you wouldn't want to drink it, so it's normally administered by a cloth to the mouth or nose. But there were no traces of any such fabric or material. No bruising around lips or residual finger marks against the back of the neck, which means there may be another method of administration.
What effect would the drugs have had? Holly said.
GHB combined with chloroform?
Yes.
The chloroform would have knocked her out, and the GHB would induce what's called a G sleep, Angela said. Which isn't sleep at all, but a state of unconsciousness. GHB inhibits the release of dopamine in the brain. At low doses, this results in a sense of euphoria, but the dosage administered to these victims would have left them suffering from dizziness, tremors, and incoherence.
Would they have known what was happening to them?
If they were aware, they would have experienced both physical and psychological fear. But they'd have been powerless to do anything about it. Their limbs wouldn't respond, and they'd suffer from depressed breathing caused by lack of air moving in and out of their lungs.
They wouldn't have been able to shout for help.
No, they'd be screaming in silence, Angela said, and turned back to the body. Moving on to the external examination of the victim. The body is that of a mature female, measuring 67 inches in length and weighing 127 pounds. She is fully developed but somewhat undernourished. I would put her age at between 40 and 50. Osteoarthritis was prevalent in both hips and her left leg, a result of poor nutrition and overall health. Lividity was noted in the distal portions of the limbs. There is no peripheral edema of the extremities.
Angela brought the magnifier down and turned on its light. She ran her hands up and down V's arms, gently pressing the hard white flesh.
There are two deep vertical scars on each wrist, highly likely to be the results of a suicide attempt some years ago. At least a decade, I would say. There are dozens of other scars across her body, mainly found on her arms and legs, but also noted on her back and shoulders. These are consistent with bouts of self-harm, and vary from hesitant 2-centimetre cuts to deeper ones, the longest of which is on the inside of her left calf and measures 23 centimetres. Do we know what this woman did for a living?
She was a sex worker, Bishop said.
Angela paused, her gloves halfway up the other arm.
Surprisingly, then, her sexual genitalia appear untouched. No FGM or assault marks of any kind. She had had sex the day she was killed, but whether with her attacker or not will be impossible to say, as no forensic evidence was found.
She angled the magnifier towards Holly and Bishop so they could see what she showed them next.
The fresh cuts and abrasions evident on the back of her hands Forearms and upper arms are defensive wounds, which means she would have been conscious at the time of the attack. Where she made an attempt to grab the knife blade from the assailant, incised wounds are noted between the thumb and fingers of the right hand, across the palms and in the web space between the bases of the thumb and index finger. There are numerous metacarpal fractures and abrasions, as well as 5 large bruises on her knees, where she may have raised her legs to protect her abdomen during the assault. Angela stepped away for a moment, then said, "And now we move on to the head." She pulled the white towel from V's face. Holly felt herself look away, then forced herself to turn back. Where the woman's eyes should have been were dark holes. There was a huge amount of discoloration and damage across the skin from the cheeks all the way up to the forehead. V's bright red hair had been tied behind her head into a bun with a tight net. She had a smoker's face, gaunt with tiny scars and spots, and her mouth was slack and open, her teeth yellow and stained. Her dentition is what one would expect of a heavy smoker. She's had several fillings and 3 extractions, and I've sent off x-rays to our forensic odontologist to see if he can help identify her. She moved her hands up to the eyes and shot a look at Bishop. This is what you really want to know, isn't it?
It is.
Firstly, I would like to bring your attention to the trace evidence of adhesive residue I recovered from the lower right eyelash, consistent with electrical tape.
Electrical tape? Said Bishop.
Normally, this material would be used to bind a victim's hands or gag them, but in this instance, it would appear the killer taped over the victim's eyes before he stabbed her.
See no evil,
Holly heard Bishop say, but she was thinking something else. Is it possible he didn't tape her eyes shut? She said slowly. Why? What are you thinking? I'm wondering if he taped them open. Open? So she would have to look at him. An uncanny silence followed, until Angela broke it, her voice suddenly loud. I can only give you the facts, but yes, that could be one interpretation. Moving on, there is evidence of extreme trauma to the nasal bone, the glabella, supra and infraorbital margins and foramen, and the inferior nasal conchi. There is an irregular pattern of cuts on the insides of the eye sockets where the knife penetrated, and I counted a minimum of 20 stab wounds to each eye. Some of the cuts may be doubles or even triples that hit the same groove. It does happen, especially inside such a small target area, so we may never know exactly how many times he stabbed her. Right or left-handed, Holly said. Right, said Angela. The attack resulted in intracranial orbital stab wounds, which caused the rupture of the globe, immediate retinal detachment, laceration to the extraocular muscles, optic nerve avulsion and lacrimal gland. Penetration into the cranial cavity occurred from the blade in both eyes via the optic canal with maximal bone fractures. The left side of the brain cortex was crushed, resulting in immediate intracranial hemorrhage. I removed the remains of what was left of both eyes, including the vitreous body, lens and optic nerve. But there was so much damage I couldn't even tell what colour her eyes were. Brown, said Holly.
Thank you.
Angela paused to record this detail on the victim's chart. The weapon would have been a heavy knife, possibly a kitchen knife or perhaps something larger, such as a hunting knife. Holly saw Bishop flinch by her side. He had his head down and was staring at his feet. He took a breath and looked up.
Is it him?
He said to Angela. The use of GHB and chloroform is not the link. Nor is the tape, which would indicate a slight shift in the MO. It's the ferocity of the attack to the eyes that is the giveaway. The grooves in the eye sockets caused by the knife are the exact same size as the wounds to the previous 2 victims. So it would appear to be the same knife. The same knife indicates the same killer. Angela took a step away from the table, and her voice was as chill as the room. I'm sorry to be the bearer of bad news, D.I. Bishop, but I'm afraid your killer is most definitely back.
Chapter 8. Bishop led Holly through the incident room. It was an amalgamation of open-plan offices and high-tech equipment compared to the last time Holly had been there. Large television screens on the walls showed newsreel footage on a loop, and bodies moved constantly, loud voices mixed with the ping of emails and phone messages. There were a few familiar faces scattered in front of her, men and women who gave her a nod or a quick smile. Tired but somehow steely-eyed, and Holly wondered if they always took it home.
"Can I get everybody's attention, please?"
Bishop shouted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.